Penguin Random House Audio presents New to Big, How Companies Can Create Like Entrepreneurs, Invest Like VCs, and Install a Permanent Operating System for Growth by David Kidder and Christina Wallace. Read by Christina Wallace, with the opening and closing chapters read by David Kidder.
This book and Bionic would not exist if not for the imagination, instigation, and drive of two incredible women, Beth Comstock and our co-founder, Ann Berkowich. This book is dedicated to you and to the entire Bionic tribe. We are beyond grateful. Once Bionic, always Bionic. Here's to the crazy ones, because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. Rob Siltanen.
This is David Kidder. Chapter 1, New to Big. What are you going to do when this partnership fails? This was a simple question, but coming from two of the most respected and successful venture capital investors, Marc Andreessen and Ben Horowitz, it felt like a one-inch punch. They were doing due diligence before they invested in the Series C financing round of my four-year-old startup, Clickable, and I honestly did not have an answer. I had never considered that reality. I was going to will it to work. As if on cue, we all nervously laughed while I tried to keep my adrenaline under control. As an entrepreneur, over the past 20-odd years, I have worked relentlessly and experienced modest success in building several venture-backed startups. I had raised over $50 million in seed and growth capital and had exited twice. But a decade ago, at the moment Mark and Ben were doling out some radical candor, I was frozen with the realization I had just made an irreversible, fatal decision in building my beloved startup. Clickable was a pioneer in the search and social marketing space. We had discovered a real pain point. Digital marketers had too many platforms to manage and too little understanding of which ones would actually move the needle. So we created and patented the ACT engine. It was a dashboard utilizing some of the earliest forms of machine learning to look across search and social campaigns and give marketers clarity on what to focus on each day. We were in the right place at the right time and quickly raised over $22 million in Series A and B financing rounds from some of the most respected venture capitalists in the world. But early on, we spotted a problem with our product-to-market fit. There were actually two groups of customers who needed us: large enterprises, who wielded the vast majority of online marketing spending, and smaller businesses, who felt the same pain but had much less money to spend on a solution. The obvious fix would be to target the large enterprises. Any entrepreneur will tell you their ideal customer is rich and in pain. But our earliest revenue came from the smaller companies, and we were reluctant to abandon them and shift upmarket. As a result of being stuck in the ugly teenage years, our growth rate had not met yet the exponential forecast required to raise another round of funding. We were burning through capital quickly. It was a classic startup dilemma. So when a Fortune 100 financial services company came knocking in 2009 with interest in pursuing a strategic partnership, we saw it as a silver bullet for our growth challenges. They were building a complete suite of digital marketing solutions for small and medium-sized businesses, and our ACT engine fit perfectly into their strategy. They had paid a fortune to a prestigious consulting firm to analyze and recommend a leading technology partner, and the firm chose Clickable, resulting in a several million-dollar partnership to launch a white-label version of our platform for their small business customers. Unsurprisingly, their customers behaved exactly as our earliest customers did. They tried it, loved it, and then left it when the free trial was over because they couldn't afford to invest in the paid version. The smartest plan you can buy was invalidated. The partnership couldn't solve our problems. Instead, it amplified them. This is exactly what Mark and Ben predicted. As serial founders and investors, they had hard-won experiences and critical answers that we severely required but did not yet possess. Convinced we could still reboot Clickable's growth, I embarked on a quest to learn from the world's best living entrepreneurs. I wanted to understand how the most successful founders decided to bet their lives on a business and then what they did in the first 5 years to keep those companies alive and thriving. What began as a series of conversations with entrepreneurs like Elon Musk, Reid Hoffman, Sarah Blakely, Robin Chase, Steve Case, and more than 40 other incredible founders turned into my last book, The Startup Playbook. What I learned was that while each founder's startup journey was unique, they all had a nearly identical collection of mindsets and lenses they used to discover the root of a customer problem and to scale a solution into a business. These growth mindsets were distilled into a framework I call the five lenses. We'll dig into three of these lenses in Chapter 7. Most entrepreneurs will tell you the best ideas and the biggest opportunities are often discovered by someone in the right place at the right time. And in this particular story, that place and time was at the TED conference in 2010, eating breakfast with Beth Comstock, then SVP and Chief Marketing and Commercial Officer of General Electric, GE. It was 2 years before I'd ultimately sell Clickable. Beth and I had been friends for a decade, and our breakfast at TED was an annual affair, where we caught up on our various professional and family adventures in between presentations from some of the most creative and brilliant minds in art, technology, policy, and more. I was describing the five lenses from the Startup Playbook when Beth stopped me mid-sentence and insisted, "We need this learning at GE." She had long owned the disruptor role at the conglomerate, leading the digital transformation efforts, including overseeing the founding of Hulu, and environmental impact work, including creating the Eco Imagination initiatives, and had recently stepped into the chief commercial officer role. She knew better than anyone that the core of the conglomerate struggled to be entrepreneurial, to operationalize the mindsets and systems of growth. "Come work with me to install this at GE," she insisted. I hesitated. I'm an entrepreneur, not a consultant. And at that point, I had a deeply personal and moral commitment to my Clickable team and investors to cross the finish line, no matter the personal costs or the timeline ahead. So we put the idea on the shelf. But 2 years later, after we sold Clickable, and just months before I published the Startup Playbook, Beth asked me to join her keynote panel at GE's global leadership meeting in Boca Raton, Florida. What I've learned from my experience as a four-time entrepreneur and angel investor in more than 30 startups is that while it often looks as if world-altering business opportunities emerge by accident, they can, in fact, be discovered and scaled in a methodical way. In the same way an MBA program teaches a form of management for administering and growing existing businesses, entrepreneurship and venture capital are, together, a form of management for discovering and building new businesses. This is crucial. Enterprises need both. It is the ecosystem created by the two that fuels world-changing innovation. This was the hard-earned, invaluable insight I gained from Clickable and our fatal Fortune 100 partnership, and it was a gift. I needed to share this insight at the GE Global Leadership Meeting. The challenge would be how to introduce this ethos and system into a traditional corporate environment. Existing corporations are focused on operational excellence and incremental improvements through process and efficiency. The MBA-driven methodology they use is about taking something big and making it bigger. This is literally the toolkit for operating what we call the big-to-bigger machine. Conversely, the integrated mindset, mechanics, and methodologies of entrepreneurship and venture capital are designed and calibrated to discover new customer needs and devise innovative and new-to-the-world solutions. It is the toolkit of the new-to-big machine. What Beth had been articulating about GE, their struggle to innovate inside the big-to-bigger machine, was an issue plaguing virtually every large organization and enterprise. GE did not have a monopoly on this problem. It was everywhere. Corporate innovation is failing at a DNA level because the big-to-bigger machine has been engineered to be incompatible with new-to-big. It is literally at war with growth. Truly new, cutting-edge ideas are too risky, too amorphous, too non-consensus to survive the metrics and evaluation process that, quote-unquote, well-run companies apply to capital investments. Bionic was born at GE's conference in Boca. It was not intended, but it happened with a single provocative question. Near the end of the session, Beth surprised the three panelists by asking us on stage if we had any questions as outsiders of the company. Off the cuff, I aimed a question from the stage down to then CEO Jeff Immelt, who was seated front row center in an audience of 700 executives. Jeff, how many $50 million startups did GE launch last year? The room shifted uncomfortably. I bet the answer is zero, I continued. And if that's true, I would be terrified if I were you. With $90 billion in the bank and 300,000 employees, how does this not happen all the time? The silence was deafening. Finally, Beth, stunned, broke the chill in the room with humor. Tell us how you really feel. The audience golf clapped.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.